Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Do you know the difference between an extrovert and an introvert? Most people think, you know, an extrovert's just very outgoing and an introvert's very shy, but it really isn't that at all. It has to do with energy. Extrovert gets their energy from being around people, and an introvert loses their energy from being around people. You know, an extrovert will come home from a party all pumped up, all chart or a conference or something, and the introvert will get home and just shut down completely. Doug knows very well I'm an introvert. I can go to a conference and come home and not speak to him for at least 12 hours. It's not that I'm not happy to see him, I just have no words. I have no words left, they're all gone. How many extroverts do we have? Good, we've got some extroverts. We need you guys. And introverts, I guess, are the rest of us, right? Without the extroverts, where would we introverts be? Oh my goodness. Now, no matter what it does to our energy level, though, we all need to be connected to other people. We need to have we need to know that we're known and understood by somebody who cares about us. We know that there's somewhere and someone that we can turn to for help. Now, we all pretty much like to think of ourselves as independent and self-sufficient, but at the deepest level, we're completely helpless and utterly dependent upon the one who knows us and created us for himself, our Heavenly Father. He not only holds the whole world in his hands, he holds our lives, even our breath, in his hands every day. But we don't like to feel helpless, do we? One of the hardest things in life is facing a physical limitation and no longer being able to do something that you used to do, especially if it's something you used to love to do. But yet that's something that happens to each and every one of us. The older we get, there become limitations. We just can't do what we used to do, or at least not in the way we used to do it. Well, the Bible uses a very consistent image to describe us, but it doesn't connect well often because of those things I just mentioned to you. The Bible calls us sheep, and sheep are helpless animals. They have to have a shepherd to watch over them and to protect them. But that's what the Bible says we're like. It says, look, we're all like sheep, and we're all in need of a shepherd. God used this metaphor a lot to describe his relationship with his people. We heard it in the Old Testament reading that Aaron read, that he is the shepherd of the flock of his children. And but when we got to Jesus, that imagery took on a whole new meaning. Because in Jesus, he not only said he was the good shepherd, he proved it. In that passage from John's Gospel that I just read to you, he gave a description of what being the good shepherd meant. He said that the good shepherd knows his sheep. Verse 3 says that he knows us by name and that we can know him. That we can all learn to recognize his voice in the very many different ways that he speaks to us. We can learn to follow him, just like the sheep follow their shepherd. The good shepherd protects his sheep. Verse 15, he says that he lays down his life for us. And that's literally what he did, isn't it? On Good Friday, on the cross, he gave his own life to save us from the penalty of our sin. In a sense, you know, he's protecting us from ourselves. Apart from Christ, we are hopeless sinners. But when we put our trust in him and follow him as the good shepherd, we find forgiveness and we find strength and purpose and healing. The good shepherd gives his life. And he gives us life, not just survival, not just getting us from one day to the next, but abundant life, the fullness of life. Following Jesus means that we can know joy and peace even in the worst circumstances that we face. We might still face them, but with his presence in us and with us, we can be sustained and overcome it. But the Bible uses another image to describe us as well in our New Testament reading today from 1 John 3. That's a little bit easier to identify. It calls us children. Thank you for the visual cue there. Victor's helping me out this morning. Yet like sheep, children are completely helpless. They are dependent upon their mothers and fathers. They need someone to watch over them and protect them and care for them. Someone who knows them well. And that's what we have in God, our Heavenly Father. Someone who knows us and loves us. And his love for us is extravagant. I want you to turn with me in a Bible close by, hopefully, to 1 John chapter 3. Almost at the end. So when somebody finds a page number, let holler it out so that you can find it. Chapter 3 of 1 John. 1208 is the page number. 1208. 1 John 3, starting at the first verse. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Now, we might not be able to identify too much as sheep, but we all have been children. We've all had fathers. So perhaps this language is a little bit easier for us to connect with. Yet, God, the Father's love, is not like anything we've ever experienced. No matter how wonderful an earthly father we have, God's love is even better still. It's in a category all of its own. It's love that takes the initiative. Love that pours out blessings and grace on the undeserving. And when you think about God's holiness in comparison to our sinfulness, you wonder, why would he even bother? Where's the attraction for him? He is completely stainless and holy and pure, and we are sinful, fallen, broken creatures. Where's the attraction? Why would he want a relationship with us? It's a mystery, but it's a wonderful mystery. It's a wonderful one. God's love is the kind that transforms everything. It's kind of like the Midas touch. Remember that old story about Midas? Everything he touched turned gold. Everything God's love touches is changed and transformed and made better. It turned rebellious sinners into beloved children, like we read about in 1 John. It turned 12 frightened apostles, the disciples, into 12 apostles who started the church that is transforming the world. And it can take anything that is in your life that brings pain or fear and transform it into strength and hope and trust. In fact, verse 2 says it's making us to be more like Jesus. Let's look at verse 2. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. It's through faith in Jesus that we become children of God. And the Bible describes the way we become children as adoption. And I found a really good definition of adoption. It says, adoption is a legal action by which a person takes into his family a child who is not his own, who has no rights within that family, in order to give that child all the privileges of his own children. From having nothing to having everything by the will of the Father. It's a really good analogy, isn't it? It's a perfect analogy. When we think about it, that it describes just how far away from God we are without Jesus. Left on our own, left to our own resources and our own devices, we're lost and left in our sinful state. We might be part of God's creation, but we're not part of his family. We don't have those rights and those privileges. And we don't have a future or a hope either. We may feel that we're independent and self-sufficient, but the self that we're trusting in, the self that we're relying on, can't save us. Yet God doesn't want that for us. He wants to lavish his love on each and every single person that he has created. And he wants to call us his own children. That's why he sent Jesus, to show his love in a way that we could grasp, in a way that we could understand, and to die for us in our place on the cross. And when Jesus rose and returned to the Father, he sent the Holy Spirit so that love can continue to be lavished out on us. Even in his physical absence, his spiritual presence is there in the Holy Spirit to guide us and protect us, to continue to shepherd us, to be our good shepherd. It's hard to fully accept this kind of love. Even when we've asked to receive it, you know, we still find ourselves trying to earn it, trying to deserve it. We want to be good enough for this love. It's so good, we want to be good enough for it. Something in our human nature does that. And the sad thing is, if we keep trying to earn it, our Christian faith really becomes a drudgery. You're striving to earn something that you'll never earn. You're striving to be good enough for something that you can't be good enough for. It's a gift. And what happens if you're caught up in that cycle, it's like being on a treadmill. You're working really hard, but you're not getting anywhere, right? So when tragedy comes along, You think, well, God, how can you let this happen to me? Look what I'm doing for you. How can you let this happen to me? And the very faith that should sustain you in the midst of that tragedy or that trial crumbles. You're in a storm and you're blown over at the first wind. But that's why it is so amazing that God won't let us earn it. He will only give it to us freely. To be God's child is to have hope. And I love how Hebrews defines hope. The author of Hebrews calls it an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It's Hebrews 6:19, an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. You know, a good ship's anchor will hold it through a bad storm. It will keep it safe and anchored to the bottom. And life can get pretty stormy sometimes. The waves can get pretty big. And without faith or hope, without the Lord, we would be lost at sea. But there's another side of this that we need to look at in 1 John 3. Look at verse 3. It says, all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. To say that we have this great hope and then yet be unconcerned about the sin in our own lives would be to be walking in darkness. We can't truly know the love of our Father, our Heavenly Father, and yet wish to walk apart from him. His desire is for us to walk with him and to make us more and more like himself, more like Jesus. And if we're not yielding to that love and that transforming power in the love, we're following a different path than the one that he's laid out for us. Verse 6 is a tough verse. It's a very tough verse in this passage. It says, no one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Well, I don't know about you, but unfortunately, I keep on sinning. I don't want to, but I do. And John's not saying that true Christians never sin. That's not what he's saying at all. He'd be contradicting himself. Because in 1 John 1:8, he says, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So clearly, he's not contradicting himself. Because in the next verse of that first chapter, he reminds us of God's provision for us when we do sin. He says, if we confess our sins, ergo we have them to confess, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We fail. We fall. But we can still be forgiven. And we'll never forget that the grace of God that he lavishes on us so freely at no cost was at great cost to his son Jesus, at the cost of his own life. So while we will never lead a sinless life this side of heaven, because of our love for him, because of our gratitude for what he's done for us in Jesus, we are called to turn from that sin daily. To confess it and return to the cross with it daily, whenever it happens. To go on sinning apart from acting upon it and the grace that we've been giving, I think is what he's talking about. And just ignoring that. That's the walking in the darkness. But to, whenever we stumble, turn back and say, Lord, forgive me. That's receiving and living in that grace that he gives us. Your Heavenly Father wants to make you more like Jesus. But you have to let him. Let him love you. Let his love do that transforming work in your life. It sounds so easy. I mean, who wouldn't want Jesus to love them? It just sounds ridiculously easy, but the truth is, sometimes when we've fallen too hard or too far, we won't let God love us because we feel like we've fallen too far and too hard. We don't deserve it. Or if someone has made us feel so worthless or ridiculed us or abused us in such a way, then we don't feel worthy of it. But the nature of God's love is unique. It's his very essence. God is love. And like him, it's perfect. We don't deserve it. We'll never be worthy of it. But that's not the point. The point is that God longs to lavish it upon us. He longs for us to let him love us and to allow ourselves to belong to him, to become his adopted children. The only thing that's preventing that from happening is what? Ourselves. That's the only, every other resource under heaven is working to make that happen. And the only time it can't happen is when we say no. Either actively or passively. Just say no. God's love is shown perfectly to us in Jesus, the Good Shepherd. He loves all of his sheep. He loves the strong and the weak. He loves the old and the young. He loves the beautiful and the ugly. He loves the smart and the slow. His banner of love is over all of his sheep with his care and his protection. And under that loving care, we are transformed to become more like him. The reality that God is showing us this morning in these scriptures that we've read, this Good Shepherd Sunday, is that we're helpless beings. It's an uncomfortable truth, isn't it? But the one who created us for himself provides his loving care. And in that loving care, we have everything we need for this life and for the next. He longs to pour out that love for us and to call us his own, if we will let him. But we have to let go of our pride and our resistance. We have to let go of our need to do things our way and live on our own terms, according to our own strength and our own understanding, and yield to that care and guidance. Simply put, we just need to let God love us. And as we let God love us, we need to show that love to others. Help them find that love for themselves. That's our mandate. As we have received, we are to give. You have to receive it first, though. You can't give away what you don't have. Receive it and then give it to others. I found a beautiful poem that speaks to this. It's based on our 23rd Psalm that we read this morning. So let's close in this prayer. Lord of the 23rd Psalm, I have known death, and you have refreshed my soul. I have known fear, and you have comforted me. I have known hunger, and you have set a feast before me. In the darkest valley, no calamity of humankind or nature has separated us. Teach me to walk as you walk, beside those in mourning, so that they will know joy. Beside those in fear, that they will know comfort. Beside those in hunger, that they will feast until their cup overflows. As your goodness and love follow me, may mine follow my neighbor. That the threat of the worst terrors may turn to the knowledge of the comforts of the house of the Lord, where you have invited us to dwell forever. And so let me strive to help build on earth what you have promised us in heaven. In the face of all calamity, present and yet to come, let me lead my neighbor beside quiet waters, the quiet waters of the Good Shepherd. Amen.
Amen.